Hello friends, welcome to a new topic today. In this chapter, we are going to learn about umbilical cord. Okay, the length of the umbilical cord is 40 to 70 centimeters. Umbilical cord is the structure which is connecting the baby and the mother. Okay, it has two arteries and one vein. So one thing is two arteries and one vein. So there are two arteries and one umbilical vein. During development, there are two umbilical veins, but the left vein is only left, whereas right vein disappears. But left vein is left, whereas the right vein disappears. Then this umbilical, so if you see, this is Wharton's jelly, which is seen. Okay, so this is the Wharton's jelly which is filling the umbilical cord, and it is a derivative of mesoderm, and this Wharton's jelly provides a cushion, and thus because it provides a cushion, it will prevent the compression of artery and vein. Okay, now on the umbilical cord, there are some folds on the umbilical cord, and those folds are called as folds or hubocon of umbilical cord. Okay, the umbilical cord also, where does the umbilical cord develop from? Umbilical cord itself develops from a connecting stack, whereas the Wharton's jelly is derivative of mesoderm. Oxygen supply of fetus is at the rate of 5 milliliters per kg per minute, and oxygen supply is achieved at the cord blood flow of 165 by 330 milliliters of water. So oxygen supply of fetus is 5 milliliters per kg per minute, 5 milliliters per kg per minute, whereas the oxygen supply is achieved at a cord blood flow of 165 to 330 milliliters per minute. Then what are the differential diagnosis for short umbilical cord? See, short umbilical cord is seen in fetal growth retardation, abnormal lie. Obviously, in fetal growth retardation, the baby is small, so it requires just small umbilical cord. Abnormal lie or presentation, congenital malformations. Then whenever there is congenital malformations, the required the required nutrients will decrease, so we can there'll be short umbilical cord, and premature placental separation has short umbilical cord. So these are the causes of short umbilical cord. Then there are conditions where there can be excessively long cord. Excessively long cord can be present in situations of cord prolapse. Because of long cord, there will be cord prolapse. There will be cord entanglement occurs in due to the cord, long cord, and there will be true knots formation due to long cord which forms the knots. Whereas there can be a chance where the cord can be entangled around the neck, forming nuchal cord. The fetus can be in distress, and this will lead to the fetal anomalies. So excessively long cord will lead to cord prolapse, cord entanglement, true knots, nuchal cord around the nuchal cord or cord around the neck, and fetal distress. Then we have to learn about the causes of single umbilical artery. The single umbilical artery is actually the one of the most common vascular anomaly, and it is seen in 0.7 to 0.8% of singleton pregnancies, and sometimes it is seen in twins. It is seen in 0.7 to 0.8% of singleton pregnancies. It is seen in 1/4 of all infants with one umbilical artery. If you see, 1/4 of all infants with one umbilical artery or single umbilical artery are associated with congenital anomalies. So in 1/4 of the cases, there will be a congenital anomalies association. Then if you see the risk factors include black race, diabetes mellitus, twins, oligopolyhydramnios, and eclampsia, epilepsy. So what are the risk factors? Black race, diabetes mellitus, twins, polyhydramnios, eclampsia, and epilepsy are the main risk factors. It is sometimes associated with trisomy 18. What are the most common congenital anomalies? The most common congenital anomaly is cardiovascular. Anomalies are most common, but sometimes you can also see other anomalies like renal aplasia, atresia of hollow organs, limb reduction defects can also be seen. So congenital anomalies like cardiovascular anomaly is most common, but sometimes renal aplasia, atresia of long organs, and limb reduction defects are seen. It is sometimes detected under the detected by ultrasonography. The diagnosis of this single umbilical diagnosis of this condition, especially single umbilical artery, is USG. USG is the diagnosis for single umbilical artery. Okay, so this is about single umbilical artery. Next, we have amniotic fluid. The amniotic fluid, pH of amniotic fluid is 7.2 to 7.5, and osmolarity of amniotic fluid is pH is 7.2 to 7.5. Osmolarity is 260 milliosmoles per liter. The volume of amniotic fluid at term is 800 ml. The fetus swallows around 400 ml of Likert daily at term. Among all these, fetal urine is the major component of the amniotic fluid. So swallows about 400 ml, and the volume of amniotic fluid at term is 800 ml, whereas the osmolarity of amniotic fluid is 260 milliosmoles per liter. Then, how is the amniotic fluid formed? What are the formation of amniotic fluid? It depends upon the age. If it is less than 20 weeks, then it is mainly a transudate. Less than 20 weeks, it is a transudate of maternal plasma or fetal plasma or fetal skin, because the kidneys are not yet formed and there is no formation of urine. Okay, so as a result, here if it is before 20 weeks, then it is a transudate of maternal plasma, fetal plasma, or fetal skin. If it is after 20 weeks, if you see, it can occur due to the fetal urine, mainly due to fetal urine or fetal lung secretions. Transudate from fetal and maternal plasma, amniotic fluid epithelium also. Okay, so this is about the formation. Then we have amniotic fluid absorption. So if you see in the amniotic fluid absorption, this absorption of amniotic fluid is mainly by the swallowing of amniotic fluid. Mainly by swallowing, the fluid is absorbed. Some of it is absorbed by fetal membrane absorption also. So if you see, amniotic fluid is replaced every 3 hours. The color of amniotic fluid. The color of amniotic fluid is colorless. That is, if the color of the amniotic fluid is colorless, then that is preterm. If it is straw colored, then that is term. If it is amber colored or saffron colored, post-term. Golden yellow color is seen in dry RH incompatibility. Tobacco juice type of amniotic fluid is seen in intrauterine death. Whereas blood-stained amniotic fluid is seen in abruptio placenta. Green colored meconium is in fetal distress. Purulent amniotic fluid is seen in chorioamnionitis. Then, how are you going to calculate the amniotic fluid index? Amniotic fluid index calculation, if you see, first you have to divide the abdomen. This is the abdomen, and you are dividing the abdomen into 4 quadrants, and then measure the vertical depth in all the 4 quadrants. And when you add the vertical depth of all the 4 quadrants, then you get something called as amniotic fluid index. This amniotic fluid index is measured by ultrasonography in cord free area. Always you should measure the vertical depth in cord free area. You should not measure it in normal area. Okay, what is the normal amniotic fluid volume? The normal amniotic fluid volume is 5 to 25 centimeters. Then volume of amniotic fluid with age. At 12 weeks, the volume is 50 ml. At 20 weeks, 400 ml. 12 weeks, 50 ml. 20 weeks, 400 ml. At 3.2 to 3.4 weeks, it is 1 to 1.5 liters. At 40 weeks, it is 800 ml. At 42 weeks, it is 480 ml. So you should remember this one. 32 to 34 weeks, it is 1 to 1.5 liters. That is maximum. Maximum amount of amniotic fluid is present at 32 to 34 weeks. At 12 weeks, it is 50 ml. At 20 weeks, it is 400 ml. At 32 to 34 weeks, it is 1 to 1.5 liters. At 40 weeks, it is 800 ml. And at 42 weeks, it is 480 ml. then we have something called as what is the depth single deepest vertical pocket. Single deepest vertical pocket is around 2 to 8 centimeters. Now what are the functions of amniotic fluid? Functions of amniotic fluid are amniotic fluid acts as a shock absorbent. It regulates the temperature around the baby and it helps in free movements of the baby. There is no nutritive value. 99.99% of water, it contains 99% of water and 1% organic and inorganic solutes. So this is about amniotic fluid. Then we have something called as, we have to learn a few points about the lesions of the amniotic fluid. Whenever there can be two types. There can be increase in amniotic fluid or there can be normal decrease in amniotic fluid. So we call something as polyhydramnios if there is increase in amniotic fluid. So amniotic fluid more than 2 liters. Amniotic fluid more than 2 liters is called as polyhydramnios. Here in this polyhydramnios, amniotic fluid index should be more than 25 centimeters. Amniotic fluid index should be more than 25 centimeters and single deepest vertical point, vertical pocket of Liker should be more than 8 centimeters. Okay, amniotic fluid index should be more than or equal to 25 centimeters and single deepest vertical pocket should be more than 8 centimeters. That is called as polyhydramnios. Then, how are you going to classify it? Classification of this polyhydramnios is divided into first, based on the single largest vertical pocket, we can divide the hydramnios into mild, moderate and severe. Mild if the single largest vertical point is 8 to 10 centimeters. Moderate if single largest vertical point is 12 to 15 centimeters. Severe if single largest vertical point is more than 15 centimeters. Now, what are the causes of polyhydramnios? What is the causes of polyhydramnios? Most common cause is idiopathic. Along with that, we have maternal causes and fetal causes. So, in the maternal causes, see, you will have to remember it. The conditions where there can be increased amniotic fluid is, it can be due to diabetes mellitus, where there is macrosomia and polyhydramnios association, RH incompatibility, in cardiac renal anomalies, because kidneys are the one which will form the amniotic fluid, right? So whenever there is renal anomalies, so obviously cardiac and renal anomalies with mother is also associated with polyhydramnios. Multiple pregnancy and diabetes insipidus is associated with mother. Then if you see the fetal amniotic fluid is formed by renal and it is drained by swallowing, right? But if the fetus is unable to drink and swallow, then the conditions where the fetus has inability to drink and swallow will cause polyhydramnios, right? So those include we have esophageal or duodenal atresia, cleft lip, cleft palate, anencephaly. We have esophageal and duodenal atresia, cleft lip, cleft palate, anencephaly, congenital diaphragmatic hernia, goiter, cystic hygroma. Congenital diaphragmatic hernia, goiter, and cystic hygroma. So these are the conditions where fetus is unable to drink or swallow. Then sometimes there can be increased secretions, that is increased urine secretion. This can also lead to polyhydramnios, or it is sometimes associated with chromosomal abnormalities, most commonly trisomy 18. It is associated with chromosomal abnormalities, most commonly trisomy 18. Now what are the clinical features? This is the there is increased Liker in the amniotic fluid, and as a result this will push the diaphragm is pushed up, so the lungs are compressed due to distension. The lungs are compressed, so the patient suffers from breathlessness. There will be pain in the abdomen, and you will also see because of this polyhydramnios that is associated with decreased fetal movements also. So if you examine the abdomen looks over distended and tense and shiny. The abdomen looks over distended, tense and shiny, and uterus is more than the period of amenorrhea. because of this increased amniotic fluid, the fetal sound, heart sound, is not heard properly. Okay, and there will be history of malpresentation. So these are the things which you see in on examination. So if you see complications can be it can cause preterm labor, premature rupture of membranes, malpresentation, cord prolapse, abruption, postpartum hemorrhage, and subinvolution of uterus. It's simple because of, there is polyhydramnios, that is increased amniotic fluid. Because of increased amniotic fluid, this will put pressure on it will cause distension. Instead of saying we can tell it will distend, okay, because it will cause distension. It will activate the uterine muscles and it can cause preterm labor, okay. Because it causes preterm labor, it can lead to postpartum hemorrhage, number one, and there is increased amniotic fluid. So the thing is, whenever there is increased amniotic fluid, fetus can rotate easily, has more space, fetus has more space to move, so it will lead to more malpresentations, right? Because it can rotate easily, the fetus can rotate easily, that will lead to a malpresentation. Whenever there is increased amniotic fluid, the cord can also prolapse, right? Because it has more space to move, okay, and because of this distension and preterm labor, this can cause PPH, first abruption, okay. This abruption can in turn lead to postpartum hemorrhage, premature rupture of membranes, okay, postpartum hemorrhage. Now this postpartum hemorrhage can lead to subinvolution of uterus, okay. So these are how the complications of polyhydramnios are interrelated, okay. Next we have, how are you going to treat the condition? The treatment of condition is, if the gestational age is more than 37 weeks, then deliver, okay. But the problem here arises when the gestational age is less than 37 weeks. When the gestational age is less than 37 weeks, check for respiratory distress. If there is respiratory distress, because there can be respiratory distress, right? So number one, you can do amniocentesis. Because it is 37 weeks, less than 37 weeks, the lungs are not formed properly. One, you can do amniocentesis. In amniocentesis, you can withdraw or remove 1000 to 1500 ml of fluid can be withdrawn slowly for approximately 30 minutes. You can withdraw 1000 to 1500 ml of fluid slowly for approximately 30 minutes. And USG guidance with the spinal needle, along with USG guidance and spinal needle, you can withdraw 1000 to 1500 ml of fluid slowly for approximately 30 minutes. Then you have indomethacin. You can also give indomethacin. This will cause this indomethacin actually causes vasoconstriction and thus decreases the urine formation. Okay, once the urine formation is decreased, this will decrease the polyhydramnios. But it has one of the important side effects, is it causes early closure of patent ductus arteriosus. So because of this early closure of patent ductus arteriosus, it cannot be given after 34 weeks because of this early closure of patent ductus arteriosus. Then sometimes this polyhydramnios is also associated with fetal hydrops. So polyhydramnios with fetal hydrops causes something called as mirror syndrome. In this mirror syndrome, this is called as mirror syndrome. So this mirror syndrome is a maternal condition, where this maternal condition will mimic the fetal condition. Here what actually happens is, in this mirror syndrome, the maternal condition will the mother tries to mimic the fetal condition, and because the mother tries to mimic the fetal condition, there will be symptoms like edema, proteinuria, or pregnancy induced hypertension are seen in mother. Okay, that is mirror syndrome. Then we have to learn some few points about oligohydramnios. In oligohydramnios, whenever there is decrease in fluid, there can be a chance where there is decreased fluid for less than 200 ml. If there is decreased fluid for less than 200 ml, or if USG has in USG, you can see maximum vertical pocket of less than 5 centimeters. One, there is decreased fluid we call something as oligohydramnios, where the amniotic fluid is less than 200 ml, or on USG you see the vertical deep vertical pocket, if it is less than 5 centimeters, then we can call it as oligohydramnios, or amniotic fluid index can be less than 5 centimeters, even then you call it as oligohydramnios. Now, what are the etiological features causing oligohydramnios? If you see etiology of oligohydramnios, one, we have fetal causes. Here, in the fetal causes, the main important thing is think that fetus is not passing urine. The baby is not passing urine. If the baby is not passing urine, then obviously there will be decreased amniotic fluid volume, and thus it causes oligohydramnios. What are the conditions where baby is not passing urine? If you remember, the urine is mainly passed due to the why is urine passed? It is due to the how is amniotic fluid produced? Amniotic fluid is produced from the urine. Majority of the amniotic fluid is from the urine. So whenever there is problem in the production of urine, then obviously there will be oligohydramnios. So one of the cause can be a problem in the renal, that is causing renal agenesis. Okay, renal agenesis, so kidney is not formed, so urine is not formed. It can be due to posterior urethral valve. So in posterior urethral valve, there is obstruction of urine flow because of this valve in the urethra. So obviously, though the urine is formed, this is not draining outside. There can be multicystic dysplastic kidney, where there is no induction of kidney development by mesonephric blastema. So as a result, there will be multiple cysts in the kidney without proper renal parenchyma and collecting ducts, and as a result the urine is not formed. It can be due to polycystic kidney disease, where in the kidney you see many cysts are formed in the intrauterine life itself, or it can be due to IUGR. So all these can lead to oligohydramnios. So what happens if there is IUGR? How is IUGR leading to renal agenesis? Whenever there is IUGR, it causes uteroplacental insufficiency. This will lead to hypoxia. This hypoxia causes renal artery vasoconstriction. Okay, because of this renal artery vasoconstriction, this will decrease the GFR. Renal artery vasoconstriction will decrease the GFR. So this is what happens in IUGR. Then it can also be due to torched group of infections and chromosomal abnormalities, which can cause oligohydramnios. Some other causes include, we have placental causes. In placental causes, we have something called as amnionodosum. In the placental causes, we have amnionodosum. So what is this amnionodosum? This amnionodosum is a tiny, light, creamy nodules of amnion made up of vernix caseosa with hair and degenerated squamous sebum. So this is amnionodosum, which is the amnionodosum which you are seeing in the picture, where a nodules are formed in the amnion and it is made up of vernix caseosa with hair and degenerated sebum. Vernix caseosa, hair and tiny light tan cream colored nodules on amnion made up of vernix caseosa with hair, degenerated squamous and sebum. What are the maternal causes of oligohydramnios? Maternal causes of oligohydramnios can be anemia, hypertension, autoimmune disorders, drug abuse and alcohol. Drug abuse like alcohol and cocaine, premature rupture of membranes, smoking, post-datism, drugs like indomethacin, ACE inhibitors and diuretics. So oligohydramnios are caused by anemia, hypertension, autoimmune disorders, drug abuse, alcohol, cocaine, premature rupture of membranes, smoking, post-datism, drugs like indomethacin, ACE inhibitors and diuretics. Now, what are the risk factors of oligohydramnios. If you see what happens due to oligohydramnios, oligohydramnios can be divided into early oligohydramnios and late oligohydramnios. In the early oligohydramnios, it is associated with limb reduction defects, pulmonary hypoplasia, amniotic band formation and amputation. Okay, why is there limb reduction defects? I'll tell you. So this amniotic fluid will compress, so this fetus, the amniotic fluid which is very less in this babies, this will compress the fetus. So this because the amniotic fluid is very less, the uterus is in direct close contact with the fetal body. So as a result, this uterus, normally amniotic fluid will provide a cushioning effect on the to the fetus. Okay, but here this cushioning effect is lost, and as a result the limb reduction defects have been occurs. And amniotic fluid is very important for pulmonary hypoplasia, especially for surfactant production. Okay, amniotic fluid is very important, but here due to the deficiency of amniotic fluid, this can lead to pulmonary hypoplasia and amniotic band formation can occur. This is because there is no or decreased amniotic fluid, so amniotic membrane and everything becomes thickened and leading to formation of amniotic bands, which can cause amputation. So in these conditions, you will have to do the treatment of this condition is amnio infusion is the treatment of choice for this condition. And we have late oligohydramnios. In late oligohydramnios, the patient can have fetal distress, and you'll have to treat the underlying cause for treatment of late oligohydramnios. Okay, so this is about the oligohydramnios. Thank you guys for watching my lecture. In the next class, we will learn about next important thing. Thank you.